Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Hello friends, today we are going to discuss the topic of Phillips curve, which is a part of Unit 3, that is inflation, unemployment and labour market. We have already understood that what do you mean by inflation and what is unemployment. Now this particular topic of Phillips curve is trying to find a relationship between the inflation rate and the unemployment rate. In this lecture, learners, we will be understanding that what exactly is this short-run policy trade-off between inflation and unemployment. Thereafter, we will also be seeing that how a short-run Phillips curve is different from a long-run Phillips curve. And then we will be understanding that how do expectations have an impact on the Phillips curve. So let us start today's lecture. Before understanding that what exactly is Phillips curve, let me take you back to the aggregate supply curve which we have already introduced. If you remember, when we understood or when we tried to find that what is the shape of the aggregate supply curve, we had seen two schools of thought. One was Keynesian, or what was given by Keynes, and the other was the classical school. We had understood there itself that Keynes has talked about a type of a aggregate supply curve which is inverse L-shaped, and thereafter the Keynesian or the modern economist has talked about an aggregate supply curve which is made up of three ranges, one which is inelastic, the other which is intermediate, which is upward sloping, and thereafter it becomes vertical, as compared to the classical economist who had talked about an aggregate supply curve which is always vertical, showing full employment level in the economy. In order to explain this Phillips curve, we will take the Keynes aggregate supply curve, which is inverse L-shaped. Learners, what does this inverse L-shaped aggregate supply curve show? It showed that in an economy, when there is recession or when there is low growth rate, we see that the supply can be increased or real GDP can be increased without a change in the price level. Therefore, aggregate supply curve remains horizontal. So this is what Keynes has advocated, that in order to increase the GDP in the economy, we should increase aggregate demand, and this change will bring the increase in GDP without changing the price level. Thereafter, he said that once the potential GDP is realized, the economy is in full employment, and then your aggregate supply curve would become vertical. So that is what he meant by this inverse L-shaped curve. So going by this inverse L-shaped aggregate supply curve, it showed that there is no clash between inflation and unemployment. Why? Because if we are operating in the horizontal portion of the aggregate supply curve, any increase in the GDP which increases the employment or reduces the unemployment will not bring any price change, hence inflation will not be there. So there was no clash between inflation and unemployment. In order to see whether this model actually operates or not, it was A.W. Philip, who was associated with London School of Economics, he tried to do an empirical research on this by taking the data from United Kingdom scattered over almost a 100-year period. That is, he took a data from the United Kingdom of the nominal wage rates and the unemployment rates from 1861 to 1957. So from 1861 to 1957, this data was taken by him of what? Of the nominal wage rate and the unemployment rate, and then he plotted it on a graph. And he got a scatter diagram. And what did this scatter diagram show? It showed that there was a stable but an inverse relationship between the rate of changes of money wage, that is the nominal wage rate, how they changed, and the unemployment rate, these two variables were related to each other in a non-linear fashion, but in an inverse fashion. What does it mean? That in simple words, it meant that after plotting the data of almost 100 years of UK of the nominal wages and the unemployment rate, he found an inverse relationship between the rate of change of nominal wages and the rate of change of your unemployment rate. Means it showed that when the nominal wages increased, the unemployment decreased. Or when the unemployment increased, your wages decreased. So the trade-off, which was not shown anywhere in the Keynes aggregate supply curve, was somehow in empirical research was absent. So it meant that according to A.W. Phillips, if we can see a stable inverse relationship between two things, that is the rate of change of money wage and the unemployment rate. Now this was found to be very interesting, and this kind of relationship or this kind of research was carried out in US also by Samuelson and Robert Solow in 1960s. And they found that the US inflation rate and the unemployment rate were negatively correlated again. So what Phillips had done was, he had taken the change in the wage rate, whereas Samuelson and Robert Solow took the inflation rate, because ultimately they said that when the wage rate changes, it will change the inflation rate also, because we have already understood the cost push inflation. So they took the US inflation rate, they took the unemployment rate, and then they named it the Phillips curve, because they found a negative relationship between inflation and unemployment. Why they name it Phillips curve? Because it was A.W. Phillips who initially started this research. So Phillips curve, if you want to define, we will say that Phillips curve is a short-term trade-off between inflation and unemployment. Now, one implication of this Phillips curve is on the government policy, because for the policymakers, there is a choice now that whether they want a higher inflation rate in order to reduce unemployment rate, or do they want to sacrifice on the inflation in order to take care of the unemployment. So that trade-off is, you know, that's a policy choice which the government now has to make. That is whether, because see, when we talk about macroeconomic policies, every policymaker would like to see a low inflation rate and low unemployment rate. But somehow, this Phillips curve has said that you have to now make a choice whether you want a higher inflation rate and lower unemployment rate, or vice versa. So this trade-off between inflation and unemployment was found to be stable, and governments and policymakers across the world started thinking that in order to keep inflation at a certain level, we will have to sacrifice some level of employment. So we have understood the story behind this Phillips curve. Now let us derive this Phillips curve. Phillips curve can be derived by using your aggregate supply and aggregate demand model. As you see in this slide, the first panel is giving you the price and output relationship, showing a short-run aggregate supply curve sloping upwards and an aggregate demand curve which is sloping downwards. We have already understood that how the interaction of the aggregate supply curve and aggregate demand curve determine the equilibrium price. So the point where AD1 is intersecting your short-run aggregate supply curve SRAS, this is your equilibrium price, P1, and Y1 is the equilibrium output. So they are meeting at point A, where P1 is the equilibrium price level in the economy and Y1 is the equilibrium level of output. Now, in order to derive the Phillips curve, let us take at this level of price P1, the inflation rate, let us say, is 3%. So you have an inflation rate of 3%. And when the inflation rate is 3%, the unemployment rate is 6%. This is derived in the economy. Now, in order to reduce the unemployment rate, Let us assume the government takes up expansionary policy, let us say expansionary fiscal policy, which shifts the aggregate demand curve to AD2. We get a new equilibrium where the price level is P2 and equilibrium level of output is Y2. That is, with an expansionary fiscal policy, we see more output being produced from Y1 to Y2. It automatically means increase in the level of GDP has reduced the level of unemployment, because with increase in output, more people are getting work, more employment is getting generated, so unemployment has reduced. But what do we see also is that the price level has increased from P1 to P2. So if the price level is P2, let us say at this the inflation rate is 5%, but because output has increased, unemployment rate has decreased from 6% to 4%. So if we join these two points A and B in the next panel, we get this curve, which is called as the Phillips curve, which is downward sloping. What is it indicating? It is indicating that when the inflation rate is more, your unemployment is less. But when the inflation rate changes, your unemployment rate also changes. So a Phillips curve is showing an inverse relationship between inflation rate and the unemployment rate. So the policymakers, if they want to fix a low, or if they want to intend to have a low inflation rate, they will have to sacrifice on the employment and will see an increase in the unemployment rate. So a Phillips curve, I repeat again, is giving you a relationship which is negative or inverse between two variables, inflation rate and unemployment rate. How have we derived this Phillips curve? In order to derive the Phillips curve, we have taken the help of your aggregate demand and aggregate supply model. So, the short-run Phillips curve is basically, as we just said, it shows a negative relationship between unemployment and inflation rate. And this is another way of understanding your aggregate supply curve as to why it is upward sloping. Now, if we see this, why it is upward sloping, we have just understood when the price level is rising. See, a question arises is, why is it we see an inverse relationship between inflation rate and unemployment rate? See, when the price levels are rising, as we saw, let us say the government had adopted an expansionary fiscal policy, pushing up your aggregate demand curve from AD to AD1, it led to an increase in price level from P to P1. When the price level rises, automatically the real wages are going to fall. A fall in the real wages would mean that the supply or the demand of labor will increase. And then, of course, when the labor, more of labor will be demanded, unemployment will decrease. So along the Phillips curve, we see a rise in price level, which meant an increase in inflation, also led to a lower level of unemployment. So an increase in quantity of labor employed meant decrease in unemployed people and a decrease in the unemployment rate. So this is how your aggregate demand and aggregate supply model is leading us to derive the short-run Phillips curve, because with any increase in price, the real wage fell, a fall in real wage led to more demand of labor, an increase in price meant inflation increases, more demand of labor meant unemployment rate decreased. So as we just discussed, the short-run Phillips curve is basically giving you a policy menu to the policymakers. That is, if they are using fiscal and monetary policy to affect the aggregate demand, your Phillips curve will give you few choices. That is, the policymaker can, one, adopt for low unemployment with a high inflation rate, or low inflation with a high unemployment rate. That is, it is giving them a trade-off. Either reduce unemployment but take care of your high inflation, or choose low inflation but then you will have to sacrifice the employment and hence you might see a high unemployment rate, or anything which is in between both of them. So therefore, Phillips curve all around the world in the advanced economy was seen as a stable relationship between unemployment rate and inflation rate, and the policies revolved around this Phillips curve. So this particular Phillips curve was managed very well, or it was seen to be stable till the 1916. However, as you can see this curve, if we are seeing inflation rate on the y-axis and unemployment on the x-axis, we are seeing this red line from 1961, 62, 63, 68. We saw an inverse relationship between inflation and unemployment rate. When inflation rate was high, unemployment rate was low. For example, in 1968, we saw inflation rate of 4% and around 3%, 3.5% in unemployment rate. But in 1961, when unemployment rate was more, inflation rate was less. So this trade-off was there and it was seen to be true till 1968. However, in early 1970s, we saw the US economies saw something which was very different from the stable Phillips curve. It showed that unemployment increased despite having a higher inflation rate. That is, inflation rate was there, but unemployment was also increasing. This was termed as something called as stagflation. That is, even though the prices were rising, we were not seeing a fall in the unemployment rate. So this, you can see, is depicted by 1969, 70, 72, 73 curves. That is, unemployment is high, even though unemployment is rising, even though the inflation rate is also high. So something which was proclaimed as stable inverse relationship between inflation rate and unemployment rate was seeing a collapse in early 1970s. So why does this happen? By many modern economists, Keynesian economists particularly, they said that this has happened because of the adverse supply shock which the US economy has seen. What adverse supply shock? It was seen in the early 1970s and mid 80s that the prices of oil became very high because oil producing and exporting countries, their cartel, which is known as OPEC, they decided to increase the prices of oil. Now, since this oil was being imported by the US, the prices of high increase in prices of oil led to an adverse supply shock, leading to a change in the aggregate demand and aggregate supply model. So if we go to this panel, first panel, we are seeing the aggregate demand and aggregate supply curves meeting at a point A with the price of P1 and Y1. Now, because of an increase in oil prices, most of the companies which were using oil as their raw material, for them the price of their product increased, and an adverse supply shock shifted your SRAS, short-run aggregate supply curve, upwards. This we have already discussed in your previous units. So you see your aggregate supply curve SRAS1 shifting to the left to SRAS2. Demand remaining the same, we see a new equilibrium at point B. But at this point B, the prices have increased from P1 to P2, and side by side, your Y has also decreased from Y1 to Y2. So what has happened is that with increase, even though the prices have increased, even though we see a higher rate of inflation, we are also seeing a fall in the level of output, and hence a fall in the level of employment. A fall in the level of employment necessarily means a rise in the unemployment rate. So if we go to the Phillips curve on the second panel, initially when we were talking about SRAS1 equal to AD, we were getting a point A with a price level of P1, and let us say your inflation rate was at this particular point, let us say 3%, which corresponds to P1. But when we saw an adverse supply shock, what has happened is that your prices have increased, inflation has increased, but unemployment has also increased. Hence, we saw in the 1970s, Phillips curve collapsing, with Phillips curve shifting from PC1 to PC2. That is, you see a new level of point B where inflation is also high and unemployment is also high. That is, you are no more on the initial Phillips curve PC1 because a high inflation rate is not translating into a lower unemployment rate. Rather, a high inflation rate is being corresponded by a high unemployment rate also. So this meant that your inflation rate and unemployment rate both increased. So what was seen to be a stable relationship initially by all the policymakers between the inflation rate and unemployment rate saw a collapse. That is, what was seen a policy choice of having either a low inflation rate and a high unemployment rate, or a high inflation rate and low unemployment rate on remaining on the same Phillips curve was no more holding true. Economies were facing a problem of stagflation. That is, unemployment rate was also increasing and side by side, your inflation rate was also increasing. So how did Keynesian economists support this? They said that Phillips curve has not collapsed. What has happened is that there was an advanced supply shock due to change, high increase in the oil prices, which has shifted your short-run aggregate supply curve to the left, as we see in this first panel, from SRAS1 to SRAS2, which is pushing up the prices from P1 to P2, that is, inflation has increased, but side by side, your output has also decreased. This was the argument given by Keynesian economists when they tried to explain that why Phillips curve has collapsed or why this relationship is not holding true. But there was school of thoughts given by Friedman and Lucas, which say that this short Phillips curve, this relationship is only there in the short run, which we will be talking about later on, that how expectation in prices have led to explanation of this collapse of the short-run Phillips curve, which we will be doing subsequently in this lecture. But before moving to that long-run type of a relationship, or understanding that why this relationship between inflation rate and unemployment collapsed, let us get introduced to a very important concept called as sacrifice ratio. What we have understood in short-run Phillips curve is that policymakers, as per the Phillips curve relationship, had a choice between increasing the rate of inflation at the call or and reducing unemployment, or vice versa. Now, if the policymakers say that we need to reduce the inflation rate in the economy, means they are talking about disinflation. They are talking about a situation where they are saying, okay, let us have a low rate of inflation and let us have high unemployment also. So this sacrifice ratio is talking about that. That is, when the policymaker are having an objective of reducing the rate of inflation or disinflation, then they are saying that we are reducing our employment, or we are ready to reduce our output. So if we want to define sacrifice ratio, we say it is the ratio of the cumulative loss of GDP because we want to reduce inflation. So the ratio of the loss of GDP to the reduction of inflation that is achieved is known as sacrifice ratio. In simple terms, we are trying to understand that how much GDP loss we are willing to bear because we want to reduce the rate of inflation. Why this is happening? This is happening because we are believing in the concept of Phillips curve, the trade-off which was explained by Phillips curve. Therefore, we say it is the ratio of the percentage of output loss or unemployment for each 1 point reduction in the inflation rate. That is, if you formally want to define the sacrifice ratio, how much of your output are you willing to sacrifice? If you want to reduce your inflation rate by 1%, that is, if I say, no, let me reduce inflation by 1%, 1% reduction in inflation rate, for that, how much of GDP loss are you willing to sacrifice? That is called as your sacrifice ratio. So this formula is explaining your sacrifice ratio, that is percentage loss of output to the percentage decline in inflation rate. That is, if for example I want to decrease my inflation rate by 1%, 1% decline in inflation rate, for that, how much of our percentage output I am willing to sacrifice? That is, how much output was lost if I decided to decrease my inflation rate by 1%? That is measured by sacrifice ratio. A typical estimate of sacrifice ratio is 5. This means, in order to reduce your inflation rate by 1%, you have to sacrifice 5% one year's of output. That is a typical estimate which has been done in US. Now, in terms of unemployment, sacrifice ratio basically means how much unemployment rate has to increase in order to reduce inflation by 1 percentage point. So sacrifice ratio is basically telling us learners that how much are we willing to sacrifice on unemployment or output because we are believing in a policy of disinflation. So sacrifice ratio has basically taken its roots from the trade-off which was explained by Phillips curve. In the second part of the lecture, learners, we will be understanding that why does the Phillips curve collapse according to Friedman and according to Lucas. So that will be part of our second lecture. Thank you.